So welcome everybody to this session on holistic technology production systems and management model. Yeah, we can move to the next. Yeah, so if we look at what we have been discussing till now. So in the previous lecture, we discussed about how this right understanding provides us with a vision for a holistic development and human society, which can be seen in terms of this undivided society and universal human order. So once we have this right understanding, this understanding of this existential harmony, understanding of this coexistence, harmony and relationship, we are able to perceive a human being in the context of this existential harmony and when we see human being in the light of this existential harmony as an active unit of this existence, this nature, active and integrated unit, then we have this clarity about the role of human being in this existence. And in the light of that, we can understand what holistic development would mean, right? And what will be the kind of form of the human society. Right? So that clarity we have about how a human society would look like in place of an inhuman society, and how this human society can be realized through the process of transformation. Transformation at the level of individual consciousness, from animal consciousness to human consciousness, and transformation from inhuman society to human society. We also saw that this human society will have definite human goal. So we had identified those, human goals. And then we also saw how these human goals can be fulfilled by way of different systems in the society. Different societal systems like education, health, how they can ensure the fulfillment of this common human goal, right? We certainly looked at this human goal both at the individual level and at the level, collective level, and how it can be ensured, its fulfillment can be ensured. So we identified the human goal. We identified the systems through which these human goals can be realized. And we also identified the scope of the whole system. The scope of the whole system, which starts from the family order, which is the smallest unit, right, of human kind of existence, and it goes right up to the world family order. So that is the range, that is the scope of this human society. So the goal can be identified clearly. The systems through which they can be realized, these goals can be realized, can be identified. And the total scope of the system from family order to world family order can be identified. And that is what we did, right? So, we can recall that whole thing, but I presume that you remember what was discussed in the last class in terms of all these four things: the common human goal, the systems to ensure the fulfillment of this goal, and the total scope of the system from family order to world family order. Now, when we have such a, you know, human society, when we have this, you know, model for holistic development, then this will necessitate the visualization and development of appropriate technologies, production systems, and management models, etc., which will cater to the fulfillment of such a vision. So when we have this clarity about how this human society would look like, right, and how this holistic development towards this human society can take place, then in the light of this, right, we would realize that we will need to have appropriate production systems, appropriate systems of managing the society. So all these things would be required. So it will call for developing the production systems which are in line with this holistic development, holistic vision. We have to have technologies which is in line with this, you know, holistic development, in line with this human society. And also the management models, right, which are in line with this. So all this is required. Okay. So we need to have clarity about how these production systems would look like, how these technologies would look like, how these management models would look like, right? If we want to make sure that they are meaningfully contributing in the process of fulfillment of the human goal, right? And also for ensuring this human society. So this is what we want to discuss in this lecture, how these, you know, production systems would look like, which are in line with this, you know, human society, which is in line with this holistic vision of life that we are able to articulate. Similarly, how these technologies would look like. So what kind of technologies would be there, and what kind of management models could be there. And of course, we have to work out many more details like that. But depending upon our own context, of professional education, we are trying to focus on some of these things. So the appropriate production systems, the technologies, and the management models, which will be conducive to this, you know, process of holistic development and conducive to this holistic vision of a human society. Yes. So with this, we can see that in the present time, there is a great zeal for the development and adoption of innovative technologies and systems, of tools, techniques, and models which are claimed for the betterment of the society. So if you look at the present society, and if you look at the science, technology, production systems, and so on, management, there is a lot of, you know, talk about how to develop systems, right? The production systems, how to develop the technologies, how to develop these management models, right? And the necessary tools and techniques for the purpose, for the betterment of the society. So there is a recognition that there are problems in the society, you know, both at the level of human being and at the level of rest of nature. And therefore we have to do something to resolve these problems for the betterment of the society. Right. And what is being done in the name of this is that more and more sophisticated, you know, and complex systems are being added. More and more sophisticated and complex systems are added. But the problem is that all this is done, all this effort is going on under the influence of this dominant worldview, right, which is certainly not holistic. Right. So it is largely going under the assumption of the materialistic, you know, existence. And therefore, it is not, you know, in line with this holistic worldview that we are talking about, the holistic world vision that we have been talking about. Right. So the whole consideration of consciousness is missing. So somewhere we have this assumption that all that is the material world. So with that basic assumption, we are not able to understand the human being, and we are not able to understand the human society, and we are not able to understand the participation of human being. So though there are, you know, sophisticated and complex systems being built for improvement, you know, in the society, but effectively that does not take place because the basic worldview, the basic world vision that is there at the base of it is very incomplete. It's not holistic. As a result, what is happening is that both the structure as well as the, you know, use of these innovations, use or misuse, is often proving to be counterproductive and contrary to the long-term human welfare. So we are doing all this in the name of betterment in the society, but most of the time they prove to be counterproductive because the very vision under which they are developed is a very limited vision. It's not a holistic vision. So many times it is proving to be counterproductive, not all the time. And it is contrary to the long-term human welfare. So we are increasing more and more problems, right, rather than solving them. So we are trying to solve them, but we are increasing them. So what Rajulji was just mentioning, that most of these developed countries are spending more than 50% of their resource preparing for war. Right? And there you develop more sophisticated and more complex technologies. Right? And in the process, we are creating more problems rather than the solution. So all this huge investment and this, you know, sophisticated technology and complex systems, we are not moving towards real relationship. Right? We are not moving towards cooperation. The wars continue to be there, and we continue to prepare for the war with more and more sophisticated systems. Therefore, now there is a strong need to develop technologies and systems with holistic objectives governed by right understanding to render them conducive to sustainable human welfare, of course, through human society. So if we look at the present situation, this need for, you know, working for holistic development, working for human society, and need for developing the appropriate production systems, the appropriate technologies, and the management model, etc., has become very necessary. So what we intend to do in this session is to get some idea, you know, some idea about such production systems, the technologies, the management models, and so on. And there we'll try to get at least some, you know, basic guidelines and the basic, you know, the basic principles and the guidelines. And on the basis of that, we'll try to develop some criterion which can be a guideline for deciding on this, you know, appropriate production systems, technologies, and management models. So this is what we intend to do. And this is a very suggestive kind of thing, you know, and very, I mean, what we are doing here is, rather than going into the exact details, we are just trying to work out some of the basic guidelines, okay, which can be kept in mind while designing this, you know, appropriate production systems, the technologies and the management model. So let's look at this, you know. This is some of the holistic criterion for evaluation of whether the production system technologies and so on that we are talking about, whether they are going to contribute to this holistic development, to this, you know, fulfillment of human goal in the human society or not. So first criterion is that, is it catering to the appropriate needs and lifestyles? That is the first question that we have to ask about any of these systems, right? So in other words, we can ask whether it is in line with the comprehensive human goal, both at the individual level and collective level or not. Similarly, whether it is in line with the different systems, right, that are required in the human society for the fulfillment of human goal. And we have to ask whether it is consistent, right, with the total scope of this human society, from family order to world family order or not. So it has to feed, you know, ensure all these three things: the fulfillment of human goal, being in line with the, you know, human systems to ensure the fulfillment of this goal, and in line with the total scope of the human society from family order to world family order. So are they ensuring this or not? That we have to check. We have to ensure that either it is, you know, promoting all this, or at least it is not contradicting it. So this is important, that either it has to promote all this that, you know, we are talking about the human society, right? Or at least it is not contradicting it. So this is the meaning of catering to the appropriate needs and lifestyles, right? So the goal, the systems, the scopes, right, that we have talked about in a human society, the production system that we are designing, the technology that we are designing, right, the management models that we are designing, have to be in line with that, have to be in line with that. At least it does not, you know, we have to ensure that it does not contradict it, contradict any of these aspects. To make it more kind of focused, we are saying that it has to be eco-friendly. Eco-friendly means it has to be mutually fulfilling for the rest of nature. It has to be mutually fulfilling for the rest of nature. Right? So all the orders of nature, you know, be it the physical order or the bio order or the animal order, it has to be fulfilling for it. So when we are interacting with the rest of nature, when we are working out these production systems, the technologies, we have to make sure that this production system, these technologies are such that they are enriching for the rest of nature as well as the human being, right? Which essentially means that they are cyclic and they are renewable, and they are mutually enriching. So this is one important criterion that we have to keep in mind. Then it has to be people friendly, right? It has to be people friendly. That means it has to take care of the human being. And if you look at the human being now, we can see that it must lead to the development of the self, right? So it must lead to self-development. and must lead to mutual fulfillment in human beings. So when I'm engaging myself in this production system, in this technology, right, I must develop, right, in the process. Myself must develop, evolve in the process. And my interaction with the human being be mutually fulfilling, be mutually fulfilling. So in order to, you know, engage in this production system, this technology, this management, you know, systems, I, you know, it should lead to the development of this self, and it should lead to mutual happiness, mutual fulfillment. At least it should not contradict. It should not be otherwise. It should not violate. So I don't need to engage in a process where, you know, I am denied, my self-development is denied, or my mutual happiness with other human being is denied. Then it has to be user-friendly. User-friendly in the sense that it has to be safe, it has to be economical, and it has to enhance this human capability. It has to enhance the human capability. So these are some of the criterion which we can list down. And we are saying that in addition to this, of course, right, they have to promote local self-sufficiency and optimal utilization of local resources and expertise. So the focus when we are, you know, working out this production system, these technologies, you know, the focus should be that the level at which we are talking, for example, let us say we are talking about at the level of a village, right? Then our focus has to be that it fulfills the need of the village. So primarily it is focused around this, you know, local self-sufficiency. So we are able to identify the need, you know, of the village. So if we want to ensure this human society at the level of village, we should be able to identify the need of that village. And we should be able to focus that, you know, for while we are designing these production systems and technologies and so on. So it has to promote the local self-sufficiency. And also it has to ensure the optimal utilization of the local resources and the expertise. So the local resources that are available plus the expertise that are available. So with the expertise of the people in the village, we should be able to design these production systems and technologies. So there are two possibilities. One is that with the existing expertise, the people, you know, we have to design these production systems and technology. And if some additional expertise is required, then we should be able to train them. You know, we should be able to train them at the level of village as far as possible. And as far as possible, the priority should be for naturally available processes and systems. So this is also important that when we are designing these processes and systems, we have to make sure that they are in line with the natural systems, right? The natural processes and natural systems. So when we are talking about this production and work, you know, in the as one of the systems in human society, we said that this process of production has to be cyclic and mutually enriching. And when we were looking into that, we found that in nature, right, we have so many systems already working, okay, which has this characteristic of being cyclic and mutually enriching. So we have to start with those natural processes and systems, and we have to, you know, supplement them. Supplement them. So we have to add certain things, you know, to extend this cycle, this process, this system. Right? So rather than making everything fresh, you know, and man-made, you know, we have to think in terms of starting with these natural processes and systems and trying to, you know, augment them, trying to supplement them. So as far as possible, the priority should be for naturally available processes and systems. So these are some of the broad, you know, criterion for evaluation of the production systems, of the technologies, the management model that we are trying to work. In the light, go back, Ajay, just one. Can we go back to the slide, last slide, yes. So in the light of this criterion, okay, the general criterion, that broad criterion that we have talked about, now we can work out some specific criterion for evaluation, okay, of this, you know, production systems, these technologies, these management models that we want to develop. So the basis will be some of these basic, you know, holistic criterion, but then for a specific thing, for production system, for technologies, we can work out the specific criterion. And that is what we are placing next. Yes. So if you look at the criterion for technologies, these are some of these criteria that we have to keep in mind. Number one is, as we mentioned, catering to the real human needs. And when you are saying human needs, you know, we have to take care of the needs of both the body and the self. This is important to keep in mind, because today we only think in terms of the need of the body. And somehow we presume that if the need of the body is fulfilled, the need of the self will be taken care of, which is not very true. Then it has to be compatible with the natural systems and cycles. So rather than violating them, we have to just supplement them, you know, augment them. So much of natural systems and cycles are going on. We have to understand that and we have to augment that. For example, if you look at this, you know, whole process of agriculture. So the natural process is going on from seed, you know, falling in the soil, you know, and germinating and, you know, becoming a plant and then a tree and then flowering and fruiting and, you know. So now we have fruits and then we have seeds in the fruits. Now all this is happening, right? Without us doing anything. Now what we can do is supplement this. Right? Supplement this in terms of, you know, facilitating this process of growth, right? Putting this seed in the soil, you know, providing, you know, nutritional, you know, input, providing, you know, water if necessary. So these kind of things we can add. But as far as the production is concerned, it is taking place in a natural manner. So there is a huge cycle that is going on. I can only supplement it. I can only, you know, augment it. So this is second thing. Then it has to be facilitating effective utilization of human body, animals, plants, and other natural materials. So this is important. Not that we should try to avoid, you know, these things, but we have to ensure the effective utilization. So all these resources are there with us, you know, the material resources are there, right? Then we have the animals and we have the human beings, right? And we have the talent of the human being. So all that has to be understood, and we have to ensure the effective utilization of all this, the human body, the human self, right? Effective utilization of the animals, the plants, and other natural materials. So that is important. Today we are thinking in terms of avoiding this human, labor. Right? We want to minimize it, if possible, replace it altogether. Then it has to be safe, user-friendly, and conducive to health, conducive to human health. It has to be low cost and energy efficient. And some of these things that we are just talking about, it has to be producible with local resources and expertise as far as possible. It has to promote the use of renewable energy resources, enhancing the human interaction and cooperation, right? Rather than asking for domination, and violation. Then promoting decentralization. This is important, that if you look at most of the technologies and the production systems that we are developing today, it's getting more and more centralized. And there are many side effects of that, both in terms of, the social problem that we have, and the, the excessive transportations, and the storehouses and all that which is required. Then it has to, ensure this enhanced durability, the life cycle and the recyclability of the products. So these are some of the criterion which has to be, kept in mind when we are developing the technologies which are appropriate for contributing in the development of human society. So these are some of the criterion which we are just placing for, all of us to kind of reflect on, and come up with more concrete, details about them. And when we are developing technologies, when we are trying to work for some production system, we have to keep these in mind. Yes. So this is some of the criterion for the technologies. Similarly, we can list down some criterion for the production systems. And this is what we have done here, very broad criterions. So we are saying, in determining the type of production systems, the key question to be answered are what to produce, how to produce, right? For whom to produce, and then how much to produce, and so on. So all these questions have to be settled. Unfortunately, we are going about producing things without settling these questions. And if you remember, these questions, these issues have been discussed while studying about the harmony in society, while discussing about the human goal and its fulfillment through different dimensions of the societal system. So the needs are to be characterized in consonance with the comprehensive human goal that we have been talking about, and they have to be fulfilled through human systems defined there. So all these we have discussed while discussing about the human society, the harmony in the society. And now we can recall from there that the answers to these questions, what to produce, how to produce, all these questions is answered in the light of this fact that the needs are to be characterized in consonance with the comprehensive human goal. And they have to be fulfilled through human systems, right? This is what we have to ensure. So when we have to produce, we have to produce for ensuring, what we said, nurturing, protection, and right utilization of the body, right? And for ensuring this, you know, smooth running of the societal system. So like that, we have defined all these things when we are talking about the harmony in society. So we have to take that from there. But in a sense, what we are saying that the needs which we have identified here, you know, and therefore what to produce comes from, you know, this comprehensive human goal and their fulfillment through human systems. So this is the broad guideline that, you know, we have to keep in mind when we are talking about the production system, the appropriate production system. And if you look at some of these specific criterion in the light of that general thing that we have placed, we can see some of these specific criterion. And of course, they are also very tentative. The exact details we have to work out. So one of the criterion is that, you know, the optimal and efficient utilization of local resources and expertise, including human beings, animals, you know, all these air, solar, land, water, you know, other bio and mineral resources. So much is there in nature. So we have to keep, you know, kind of in mind that as far as possible, we have to ensure the optimal and efficient utilization of the local resources and expertise, which certainly includes all this that we have listed down. Then we have to look at the economic viability and sustainability. The sustainability is important, right? So every time we are saying it has to be mutually fulfilling, right? Mutually fulfilling with human being, mutually fulfilling with rest of nature. So if we can develop systems, the production systems, which is able to ensure this, then we can, you know, guarantee the sustainability. We can guarantee the sustainability. So it has to be economically viable and it has to be sustainable. Then we said this priority for local consumption. So when we are designing these production systems, our focus is not, you know, the exploitation of other, you know, kind of societies, other units, but the focus is the local consumption, the need of the society, you know, or the unit that we are talking about. So we have a whole range of this, you know, human society starting from family order to world family order. But when we are talking about these production systems, right, our focus is on fulfillment of the need of the, you know, society at the level we are talking about. So I was taking this example that if we are talking about on a village level, then we have to focus on the need of the people in the village, right? And then if we are producing more, we are producing more with the purpose of defining our complementarity, defining our, you know, kind of support for the other levels of human society, rather than, you know, thinking in terms of exploiting them. Yes. Then matching the pattern of production with the availability or producibility in the local environment and the pattern of consumption. This is also very important, you know, that if you look at the nature, then you will see that there are a lot of, you know, variations. So if you move, for example, from one part of India to another part of India, so much of change in this, you know, type of soil and the climate and so on, that we have to keep this fact in mind that, you know, the pattern of consumption and the local environment, you know, and what are the things which can be produced. So if we are in UP, okay, in Uttar Pradesh or the North India, the wheat can grow easily depending upon the, you know, type of soil and the climate. That extreme cold and the extreme heat is very favorable for the growth of the wheat. But rice can be grown where there is heavy rain and where this climate is not so extreme. So it is quite natural for the people in UP to eat, you know, wheat, and natural for the people in Chhattisgarh to eat rice, because, you know, that's the kind of local conditions, you know, the kind of soil and the kind of climate that is there. So that is what we are saying, that it has to match the pattern of production with the availability or producibility in the local environment and the pattern of consumption. The decentralized systems capable of meaningful employment of people in the community. So this will be interesting when we talk about this, you know, community model. Just trying to recollect some of the idea. We will see that, you know, we have to design our system in a manner that it is decentralized and it is capable of meaningful employment of people in the community. So that level at which we are talking about, it should be able to employ, you know, the people in this community, in this unit. So it has to be a decentralized system. It has to be capable for meaningful employment. Then facilitating production by masses and not the mass production in a centralized mode to the extent possible. So as far as possible, we should go for production by the masses, production by the people who are involved at that level. Right? So we have to produce, focus on their need, and we have to focus on system of production which can be, you know, ensured by themselves. And this idea of mass production in a centralized mode, you know, and making that as a source for profit, source for, you know, exploitation, is not something that is very desirable. But if you see, this is what, you know, is being the priority today. Then we have to ensure, of course, this self-development that we are talking about, or development of the self in human being. So it has to promote individual creativity, right, and sense of accomplishment. So that is also as important. And of course, we said this, using people-friendly and eco-friendly technologies, ensuring requisite qualities and quality of production, ensuring requisite quality and quantity of production, harnessing recycling, conservation, and reuse possibilities. So this is further detail about being cyclic, you know, and mutually fulfilling. It has to be safe and conducive to the health of person involved in production as well as others. Ultimately, it should be conducive for self-development. So these are some of the criteria that can be, you know, kept in mind. But as I said, that, you know, it has to be further detailed out, you know, and we can, you know, kind of put in our input in that process. So just some kind of, you know, broad outline is being drawn, you know, to get an idea about how these production systems would look like and what would be the criterion for their evaluation. Yes. But I would say that they are very, you know, tentative. But they provide some basis for further work. And that is the basic idea of placing them here. When it comes to management models, primarily these management models are to be relationship based. Right? So this we have been saying time and again, that if we can see that this existence is by way of coexistence, harmony, and relationship, then at the base of every human activity, right, what is important is this feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence. So when we are working out these management models, where the major focus is working with the human being, you know, for the purpose of working with rest of nature. So what we are saying that it has to be relationship based. Right? It has to be cooperative and ensuring justice in terms of mutual fulfillment. Right? This is important, that it has to be based on relationship. It has to be cooperative. It has to be ensuring justice in, you know, terms of mutual fulfillment with other human being. At least it should not be coercive and exploitative. It should not be exploitative and coercive. And if you look at the management models today, right, many of them, if not all of them, are, you know, based on this exploitative and coercive methods. Specifically, the whole unit working as a well-knit family. So if you look at this as a broad criterion, that it has to be relationship based, it has to be cooperative, it has to be ensuring justice in terms of mutual fulfillment, then some of this can be, you know, kept in mind as a specific criterion. The whole unit is working as a well-knit family. So either there has to be production in the family, or there has to be production, you know, and in a family-like environment. So the management of that production has to be in a family-like environment. So it has to work as a well-knit family. It has to be cooperative, motivational, and mutually fulfilling. It has to ensure the correct appraisal of human labor and skills. So this is also very interesting, that, you know, we have to keep in mind that when we are interacting with other human beings and when we are working, you know, managing the system of production or any, you know, system, social system for that matter, we have to keep in mind that this human development is important. Human development is important, right? So whatever we are doing, whatever, you know, interaction we are doing in the name of management, we have to keep track that it is leading to development of the self. Right? It is taking care of the health of the body of the human being. And it is rightly utilizing the human skills and labor. Human skills and labor. So in that sense, you know, we have to target that it leads to the satisfaction of the employer, the satisfaction of the employee, and the satisfaction of the consumer, right, for whom we are producing. And not for profit maximization. So our target should be fulfillment of human being, the employer, the employee, and for whom this production is done. And not for profit maximization. And you can certainly see what we are doing today, right? What we are doing today. Then sharing of responsibility and participative mode of management. So this is now, you know, strongly being felt, okay, that the management process has to be participative, right? And the responsibility, you know, is shared with all those who are involved in the process, okay, rather than thinking in terms of, you know, some people who are just, you know, supposed to be the owner, and the rest, you know, becoming the workers. And all the decisions lies with this, you know, owners or the management on part of these owners. And this, you know, the workers have to be just the followers. And this we have already talked about, this, you know, this continuous value addition, the self-evolution of the persons involved. This is a very focused point, you know. I was mentioning it yesterday that ultimately all that we are doing is for the purpose of fulfillment of the self. And that fulfillment of the self takes place through the self-evolution, through self-development. So that is at the core. And that we should keep in mind, that in no place the self-evolution process, you know, is kind of hindered. Okay. So it is good if it is able to facilitate this process of self-development, but certainly it should not hinder in any case. Then this effectively integrating individual competencies and complementarities. So this is important, that if we want to do this evaluation, we want to ensure this self-evolution, then we have to make this effective integration of individual competencies. Right? And we have to define the complementarity on the basis of this individual competency. So these are some of the criterion that can be mentioned, you know, here regarding the technologies, regarding the production systems, regarding the management models. But as I said, that these are very suggestive kind of thing, in a very tentative kind of thing that we have placed, right? But we can, you know, put in our effort, all of us together, to, you know, make them more specific and more detailed. And then if we can do that, then we have to make sure that whatever technology that we are working on, whatever research and development that we are doing, right? We have to work for such technologies, production systems, management models, which satisfy this criterion, you know, satisfy this criterion. So as I was saying that, this is just very tentative, you know, but it is useful in the sense that it gives you some idea about the basic criterion, which can be developed further. So we are placing it with that hope that all of you will work on it and improve upon it and make it more specific, you know, more specific to, you know, let's say production systems, and there also, you know, specific production systems, specific technologies like that. So when we do that, then probably we will be able to define, you know, professional ethics in the light of this more appropriately in different areas. In the area of, let's say, engineering, in the area of mechanical engineering, in the area of mechanical engineering and, you know, kind of energy generation and so on. Now, if you look at the present system in the light of what we have discussed till now, okay, we can see that the present systems have been largely developed under the influence of that dominant worldview, you know, a dominant worldview which is limited to materialistic perception. So the prevalent dominant, you know, world vision today is that the material world is all that is there. It does not take note of the consciousness. The consciousness, which is so important for human being. And therefore, it does not take care of the self, the need of the self, which is continuous happiness, and the fulfillment of this need of the self by way of right understanding and the right feeling, the understanding of coexistence, harmony, and relationship, and feeling of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. So this is one major issue, problem. This has caused many other problems, right? So this has caused millions of resource depletion on the one hand, and environmental degradation manifesting in the form of pollution and global warming, etc., on the other hand. So we can see when we look at the interaction with rest of nature, we have created these problems because we are not able to see the relationship with the rest of nature, you know, the harmony, you know, with rest of nature, and we are not able to fulfill that. And therefore we are creating crisis, you know, both at the level of resource depletion and at the level of pollution, the global warming, for example. The other undesirable characteristics of modern technologies and systems include their centralized configurations, right? And these centralized configurations are many times, you know, self-denial, right? Self-denial, contrary to the process of self-development, process of self-evolution. Promotion of wastefulness, excessive transportation, and substitution of human, animal, and other natural resources by man-made gadgets. So this is interesting. We have a very centralized system, or we are increasingly having these centralized systems. And the problem of this centralized system, one of the major problems is this wastefulness. So many resources are wasted in the process, right, which we don't account for. And there is excessive transportation. So for this centralized system, you have to transport, you know, things from different places because all the resources are not available at the same place. So you have to transport the resources. Then you have to transport back the, you know, the production outputs. So whatever we have produced, the products, they have to be transported back to the, you know, people for whom it is being, you know, produced. So it is told that the food that, you know, people eat in America, you know, what is there on the dining table, has traveled something like 1,500 miles. The average distance traveled is 1,500 miles. So almost 2,500 kilometers. So this calls for excessive transportation. And of course, then it calls for roads and energy usage and all that. So excessive transportation. And there is an increasing tendency of replacing this human, you know, labor and the, you know, labor of the animal. Okay. By these machines that we develop, right? And these machines and, you know, materials are based largely on non-renewable energy resources, okay, which is creating a lot of problem in turn. So our focus today, you know, has gone wrong, and it is creating all kind of problems that you all know, you know, so I'm not describing them all. Right. So this centralized, you know, production has this problem of promotion of wastefulness, excessive transportation, and substitution of this human and animal, you know, kind of resources which are there. And it is creating all kinds of problems in the society. So this problem of unemployment, and therefore this youth which are unemployed, you know, and who have been motivated for overconsumption, they start becoming a liability for the society. The animal power which is available is not used, right? So they also become a liability for the society, right? And all this is happening. And ultimately, you know, this modern systems give very low priority, or many times no priority, to human development and human fulfillment as far as human consciousness is concerned. So it does not even take note of this consciousness, this self. Therefore, it is not concerned about this development of the self, evolution of the self, right? And therefore, it is not able to take care of the human development and human fulfillment as far as the consciousness is concerned. So these are the problems that we are facing today. And if you want to come out of it, what we are saying that some of the criterion, you know, to work on this production system could be what we have suggested, right? But they have to be made more specific, right? Further details have to be worked out. And of course, there is a huge possibility that if you want to develop this production systems and technologies and all that, in the light of what we have suggested, the light of that human society, the human goal, we have a lot to learn from the systems in nature, and we have a lot to learn from the traditional practices. So the nature already has, so many processes going on through which a sustainable, nature is there already, existing for millions of years, right? So not that we are, the nature is there and this, such a huge synergic system is there in nature because human being has constructed it. No, it has been there in the nature, right? So much of, resources are being enriched by this natural process. So if you look at the forest, for example, as we were discussing in case of harmony in nature, that the soil is enriching the plant and the plant is enriching the soil. Right? The plant is enriching the animal and the animal is enriching the plant. And all these processes are going on, right? So we have to observe these processes, natural processes, we have to understand them, and they can be a base for further research. So all that we have to do is to extend these natural processes as and when required, right? And while we are extending them, okay, we have to keep in mind that they are cyclic and mutually enriching, and they do not violate this process, which is already there in the nature, right? Similarly, people in the past, in the traditions, they have tried to understand these processes and, develop these processes. So we have so many traditional practices which are available to us and which we can take as the base and work further on it. Today, what we have done is many of these traditional systems practices, which were so useful, so effective, and which survived for thousands of years, we have simply discarded them. We have simply discarded them. So if you look at these learnings that we can have, system from the systems which are there in nature and which we have been there, further developed in the traditional practices, we'll have a lot to learn. So to gain an insight into this holistic systems, we have a lot to learn from systems of nature and from traditional practices. Typically, some of these which we have, available, ready resources are available. I mean, references are available. People have worked on it and documented it. So one is this water harvesting and storage, right? And the utilization systems through ponds and other artifacts. So very interesting documentations are available to how people managed this, water, the running water, water through the rain and then the rivers and so on. So they have come up with ponds and the distribution systems of irrigation and other things. So there are people like Anupam Mishra who has written this, very good document on how Indian, society managed their water resources. Then, of course, we have these traditional agricultural practices. So after a lot of this so-called modern agriculture and the ill effects of it, now we are thinking in terms of natural farming, we are thinking in terms of, the organic farming and so on. And if, when you're thinking of that, you have a lot of these agriculture practices available in India and other part of the world, which have been there and which have survived for thousands and thousands of years. And we developed some system of agriculture, you know, the chemical based agriculture, which has created so much of problem in just 200 years. So there is a lot to learn from these traditional agriculture practices. Then we have this traditional local remedies and healthcare techniques. Right. So from that we can learn, you know, we have systems of Ayurveda and system of naturopathy and, you know, other things which are already, you know, prevalent. And many of them are now becoming more, you know, kind of popular, and people are learning it and trying to work on it further. Of course, this grain storage and food preservation systems have been there, you know, in practice, and they have been effective. Certainly we can, you know, develop them further, but they are there and we should understand and appreciate them and work further on them. We have systems of sharing food and shelter prevalent in the social and religious institutions. So this is a very interesting thing, you know, that in India and many of these traditional societies, we developed these systems of how to share food and shelter with others. So almost giving a guarantee that whoever is there and wherever he is, he'll be provided with the food and the shelter. So he does not have to worry about it, you know, and he does not have to go with a lot of resources, money, you know, wherever he is going. So that kind of assurance has been kind of provided. So like in our society, you know, whoever comes to your house, you would offer him food, right? Even to the unknown people. And this is considered to be one of the duty of the household. Right? Now it makes a lot of difference. It makes all the difference in you know, feeling safe and sound, you know, and protected in the society. And then there have been social institutions and the religious institutions who have been doing this, you know. So one of the very live system is this langar, you know, that is in Gurudwara. You are provided with the food and you are provided with the shelter. And of course, no cost. So it is provided by the, you know, these institutions, and the people have this mindset that they have to contribute to it. So the farmer, you know, when he grows wheat, you know, grain or any farm produce, he will send 10% of it to the Gurudwara first and then bring the, you know, remaining to his home. But first 10% will go to the Gurudwara. Now these kind of systems, you know, the management systems have been there in practice. They are still there. So we have to learn from them, and of course we can improve further. This family-based rural enterprises, this is another very important thing, you know, that do we take up this production, okay, in an industry, okay, which is away from the family, or we have to take the production systems as far as possible within the family. So this is one interesting point for consideration. If it is there within the family, right, it can be almost, you know, 16 hours of production. And whenever the people are free, they can contribute, right? And in the meantime, they can take care of other things also. And they can take care of each other. Right? So a lot of these issues, you know, are there. That if it is a family-based, you know, production, and if it is an industry-based production, it makes a lot of difference, right? So if it is family based, it saves a lot of this transportation and all those kind of things, you know. And of course, important thing is that, you know, you can invest your labor, you know, depend taking care of other things, and you can do it with a feeling of relationship with all the members in the family. So all these things we can, you know, we have this system of Yajmani. So relationship-based village system to ensure rural self-sufficiency. So the farmer is there at the base who is producing for everyone in the village. So he takes this sole responsibility. Okay. And then there are other, you know, kind of families who are producing other things which are necessary for the people in the village. Right. And they are supposed to provide this to every family in the village, right, without any cost. So this is very interesting. The farmer is producing to feed everyone in the village. And the other, you know, families which are supporting this farmer and, you know, fulfilling the other needs, right, they are taking care of these other needs, you know, and there is no exchange of money. So it is not an exchange, it is a distribution. So a potter, for example, will make pots, you know, and make it available to any family, you know, which is requiring it. And depending upon the kind of functions and festivals, and, you know, he will make all that available. And the farmer is producing and making it available for all these families. So it was considered the responsibility of the farmer as a guardian of the village family to take care of the, you know, food for all. And like that, every supporting, you know, family has to take care of the need of, you know, all the people in the village. So that kind of system we have to understand, you know, and kind of work on it. Then, of course, we have lot many of these rural crafts and artisan practices, you know, which have been there and which are still there, of course, fighting for their survival, but now we can understand, appreciate, and develop them. Yes, so these are some of the, you know, systems in the nature and the traditional practices that we have still surviving and which can be a source of, you know, kind of further work, okay? And provide those basic outlines, you know, for our development of these production systems and technologies and so on. With all this background, what you know, we want to do is to give you a fair, you know, just a brief idea about what kind of, you know, modeling we can do. I mean, just one example of it to give you or to set this process of thinking in you, you know, or process of kind of exploration in you. So let's look at this village community. So visualizing a holistic community model and working towards it. So it is time that we start working for actualization of the model of a human order at the village level, at least a holistic community model, you know, what we can call as Gram Swaraj, in the light of right understanding. And several groups of people have already started working in this direction seriously. As a result, many technologies and systems have been evolved, even though the full-scale demonstration of such alternative ways of living is yet to emerge. I mean, the interesting thing is that if we develop these production systems and technologies and management model in bits and pieces, right, then it is difficult. It is difficult to sustain them and make them, you know, effective. So what we need to do is, though we are working for these technologies and so on, we have to work for a model which is, you know, a community model in which all these things are put together, okay, and therefore an effective use of these can be made. So there needs to be an increasing, and widespread trust to evolve holistic technologies and systems through dedicated R&D efforts working within the framework of right understanding. So though we need to do this, you know, what we were talking about, working on these technologies and production systems and so on, but it is also important that we have to work out an overall system which can support this kind of, you know, technologies and production systems and make a meaningful use of them. So what we will do is that we'll present some details about such a holistic community model. Each one of us can try to work out the further details and come up with a working model, right? So this we will do at the end. Regarding this technology and production systems and so on, some of the topics for case studies we can just list down. And as I was saying, that these are all very tentative. You will have many more of them, okay? And you can list them down and, you know, send it back to us so we can enrich this list. So some of the topics are this renewable and decentralized energy technologies, the biomass-based energy conversion systems, the gadgets and implements to facilitate efficient utilization of human muscle power and animal draught power, decentralized wind power, micro hydel electromechanical power generation, etc. A lot of these things are there, you know, where we can work. Then we have to work on systems for water conservation and watershed management, for efficient utilization of rainwater and for eco-restoration. We have to work on technologies and architecture promoting green building materials and energy conservation. Organic and natural farming techniques, a lot of work is being done on it, but we have many more possibilities to do. Eco-sanitation techniques for small-scale decentralized sewage disposal and wastewater recycling. This is one of the major issues today, particularly in the cities, the big cities. We have to work on these low-cost, energy-efficient technologies for small-scale production systems. This is very important. And of course, we have to work for these humanistic organizations management models. So all this is a, you know, small list of what we can do in terms of research and development and extension. Yes. So essentially what we are saying is that once we have this, you know, model for a human society, right, based on right understanding, we can develop the guidelines, the criterion, we can take up the examples and case studies about the holistic technologies, about the production systems, about the management models, right? So we can work out some of the details, okay? And that is what we have been doing in this lecture. And we can also learn from the systems in nature and the traditional practices to evolve a holistic model of living, ensuring harmony at all levels. So this is the essence of what we have been trying to present. Right? So look into it and work further on it. As I said, it is all a very tentative kind of thing that we are talking about, but we've thought that it's important to talk about them, you know, to set this process of thinking in each one of us so that we can think, reflect, work out the details in a very creative manner and build up this process. So you all have to think on it, and whatever you, you know, are able to see and visualize, if you can send it back to us, we'll be able to enrich this. So with this, I will just give you that, you know, come back to that idea of a holistic community model. And this also, again, is very tentative. But I think it'll be useful for us to think along these lines. Right. So look at this, you know, kind of resources which are available in India, you know, in particular, we are, you know, taking this specific example. Right. So if you look at this model of a holistic community, you know, we can have some details for further work. So let's take a village, for example, right? Now, if you look at the resources available, the average land, cultivable land, which is available in India per person is around 0.39 acre. In fact, we calculated it for Kanpur city, you know, Kanpur district, and the land availability is more than this. Okay? But if you look at the whole India, the cultivable land available per person is 0.39 acre or almost 0.4 acres. Right. If you look at a family in the village, it will have 6 to 12 people. If we think in terms of a, you know, harmonious family, right, then we need to have 3 generations. The grandparents, the parents, and the children. So at least, you know, 6 people. And it can go up to 12 and many more, but this is the range, you know, 6 to 12 people per family. If you think in terms of 3 generations, because there are many functions in the family which has to be, you know, ensured, like education, like health management, like production. So all that can be taken care of if we have 3 generations together. So this is the number of persons in the family. So the average number can be somewhere around 10. Okay. So 10 people per family. And if you think of a village community of the size of, let's say, 1,000 people, okay, then we will have something like 100 to 150 families. Then we can see that for a family of 10 people, the cultivable land is around 4 acres. Right? Around 4 acres, because 0.4 acre is available for per person. The average consumption of the grain per person per year, if you put all this wheat and dal and all this together, you know, what you are consuming is less than 1 quintal per year. Less than 1 quintal per year. So if there are 10 people in the family, we need something like 10 quintals, right? 10 quintals of grain per year. And if you look at the minimum production of this grain, it will be something of the order of 10 quintals per acre per season. Somewhere, you know, people are growing only one season, so it can be even for 1 year. But 10 quintals you can produce in 1 year or one season. For example, if you look at it, Kanpur, in Kanpur, the wheat that is grown in one season is on an average 15 to 20 quintals of wheat per acre. It can even go more, you know, 25 acre quintals also. But we are presuming 10 quintals, you know, of grain per person, you know, acres. So if we have to produce this grain, we would need something like 1 acre of land. So the land required for grain production is something like 1 acre. Land required for production of oil seeds, vegetables, fruits, etc., let's say another 1 acre. Okay. We can do all those calculations in more detail. Land required for residence and other production activities is 0.5 acre. So this 2.5 acres of land is required for maintaining the needs of the family in terms of residence, in terms of, you know, food and all that. Then remaining land for collective planning is 1.5 acres. So if you look at this whole village now, you have around 150 acres of land which is available for collective planning. So we can think of those, you know, collective things. Yes, next, Rajuji. Can we move to the next slide, Rajuji? Yeah. So now you can see the total land which is available for village is 400 acres. Total land available for community planning is 150 acres. So this 150 acres can be planned, you know, in a collective manner. Now, out of this 150 acres, we can invest something like 100 acres for forest, cattle grazing, water management, you know, ponds and so on. We can invest 100 acres. And this will take care of all the forest requirement and the, you know, grazing requirement and the water management and all that can be taken care of in this. And then we have these roads and community buildings and community program areas, and this, you know, collective production activity, marketplace, storage units, etc., in another 50 acres. So that is how we can plan, you know, a brief, you know, kind of idea is given. But this is the you know, line along which we can think. So this 400 acres of land is available for the village, for around 1,000 people, around 100 to 150 families, right? In every family, we have three generations which can take care of, you know, education, health, right, production, and all other things. And then we have this village community where we have 400 acres of land, in which 2.5 acres is planned by the family themselves and 150 acres is managed by the village community. And there we can take care of all these five dimensions of the system, you know, the education and sanskar we can take care of. We can take care of the health system, you know, take care of the production systems, you know. So we can, you know, kind of identify the need of all the people in the village and plan to produce more than what is required. And it is quite possible. It is quite possible to produce more than what is required for all the people in the village. In fact, already, you know, if you look at the villages, you know, and do this survey, you find that they are producing 2 to 3 times more than what is required. Right? And that is how they are supporting the cities and all that. So that production is possible. Production of the food items, production of the clothes, right, production of the house construction and all those things. And they can produce more than their requirement. And therefore, they can exchange the remaining with the higher units, you know, higher levels of unit, like the city, the district, the state and nation and so on. Yes, some of the productions that, you know, you can see, can we move to the next one, Aluji? Yes. So some of the productions, the societal activities for which family will be involved, is one of them is type of productions. So we can have different types of production. We can have this cottage and village industries. We can have clothes, so, you know, the house construction, the poultry, all these things, you know, so many of them we can list down. Then one important activity is this education. So some of the families can take care of this, you know, responsibility of this education. Some families can take the responsibility of health services. And some families can take care of the inter and intra-community transactions, you know, take care of this exchange, you know, within the village and also outside the village. And there is no need for involving separate family for the purpose of ensuring justice, as this can be ensured by the representatives of the families in the community. So by representative basis, we can take care of this justice and this, you know, preservation of the rest of nature. But for production, we can, you know, identify the families who will take care of these productions of different types. We can identify the families who can take care of this education for the village community. We can identify some families which can take care of these health services, because there you need some kind of, you know, expertise. They have to be, that expertise has to be developed and preserved, you know, over generations. So we need to assign this responsibility to some families. And then, of course, some families who take care of the, you know, this system of exchange, system of transaction between the community, within the community, and with other communities outside. So this is just some idea about how this, you know, a community model can be designed, a holistic community model can be designed. And these details can certainly be worked out. When we are talking about giving, these families giving education to the village community, you know, they have to take care of all those aspects, you know, the aspects of education and aspect of sanskars. You know, what will be the content of education and what will be the process of education. All those details we have already talked about. So those details can be filled up here. So this is just, as I said, you know, giving a feel of, you know, how we can go about, you know, planning or visualizing human society, you know, different levels of human society, and how we can realize them through appropriate, you know, production systems and technologies and management systems and so on. So this is what I had to propose from my side. With this, I will leave it open for you to look into this, work on it, you know, and suggest us, you know, the further improvement.